Thank you, Pradesh. Hi, everyone. Before I start, I just want to appreciate the Leaptalk team, who's been working very hard, taking out their spare time to just organize all of this. And I think it's a great platform for everyone who's done open source and wants to do more to come up and show what they've done and really expose themselves to others as well. So let's just give the Leaptalk team a hand first. Now, regardless of how good or bad my talk is, I can say everyone clapped. So I just wanted to talk about open source today because I think it's an integral part of every software company right now. So there's no software company that doesn't value open source. Every company has some open source teams or some teams that expose what they're doing internally as open source. And I just wanted to talk about what the open source word means. So what the understanding of open source has been for us for the last 50 or so years, why open source is there in the first place, and how we can start contributing to open source and maybe join some open source projects or contribute to some in any way we can. So I'd just like to start with by asking almost the same question that Pradesh did. How many of you are interested in open source or would like to contribute more to open source? All right, almost everyone. That's great. So I think the first starting point for open source is what open source really is. So this is the Google definition, and of course it's correct, and of course it's what you would write in an exam, but it doesn't really encapsulate why we want to do open source. It basically says it denotes some software for which the original source code is made freely available and maybe redistributed and modified. So how open source started is, in the old days, people used to have things like printers and cameras and TVs and stuff like that, and they wouldn't have the source code to any of it. And of course, it's Microsoft's software, so everything was proprietary. And if you had to hack on something, you couldn't do it at all. So people started experimenting with this idea, like, what if we just gave people the source code to hack on whatever they want? If they had problems, they could fix it, or they could extend it, or they could improve it. That was the original idea from which open source started, and some of you might know people like Richard Stallman, who was behind GNU Linux, and people like Linus Torvalds, who started Linux, who really pushed this open source revolution. But this definition is a bit misleading, in my opinion, because it deals with more like what redistribution is, what does it mean to be free, and some of you might have heard that open source is free like in free speech, but not free like in free beer, and that's two different things. So we just want to clarify what open source is, and that you don't really need to think of all this baggage of licenses and distribution and free when you're starting to work on open source. So if you're working in JavaScript, you might know a person called Max Stoiber. He's the one behind style components and React Boilerplate and a bunch of other stuff, and he's a full-time open sourcer. So naturally, people always ask him, how can I get into open source? How can I do more for the community? How can I give back? How do I get started? I haven't made a single pull request till now. So, and the answer that he always gives is, you solve your own goddamn problems. That's the easiest way to start with open source. You don't think of anything else. You think of it as, I have a problem, I want to solve it. Maybe someone else has the same problem as me. Maybe they'd like a solution too. So can we collaborate with each other? Can I talk to him? Can I talk to this person? And maybe we can come up with a solution that solves everyone's problem. And in the worst case, the worst case that you have is, you have a solution for the next time. That's quite literally the worst case we have with open source, that is that you have a solution for the next time you have the same problem. And I think it's fine to think of open source only in this vacuum. You don't really need to think of distribution and licenses and all that baggage. So at the heart of open source is the notion of collaboration on solving problems. You don't really need to think more of it than this. Most people have this preconceived notion of open source that you need to have 100 contributors, or you need to have 1,000 stars on GitHub, or like it needs to be a complex project that no one understands or everyone uses. It doesn't need to be. It can be the simplest of projects. And really the ground rules, I think, for starting with open source is that you're collaborating with other people. So it's collaboration, not competition. You have to be nice to people. You cannot ask people to do things in their library that you want them to do. They have different ideas about a library that they came up with to solve it. And you cannot just go into them and say, why are you not doing these things this way? This does not solve my problem. That's not the way to go. Engage in friendly discourse, and I think that's the only way forward. Be nice to people. So I can give you an example when I think a lot of us have used React routers. So they moved from version 3 to version 4, and there were a lot of breaking changes in the middle. and everyone was super, like, there was so much hate on the React router community, it's unbelievable. But now everyone uses it, everyone likes it, and I don't see those people anymore. So really, let's just be nice to people. Having said that, there are, I think, almost a checklist of problems that you can open source from the get-go. So you can identify, you may not even think of these as problems, maybe, but if it's a hindrance to you, you can open source it, you can solve the problem for other people as well. So let's just start with some problems you can open source. You have to do something repeatedly. I think this is the most obvious candidate for open source if you're doing things too many times. So this can be things like you're deploying multiple times a day, you can be SSHing into servers multiple times a day, or I think we recently came up with this idea that I at least pay my bills via eSeva. So I pay my telephone bills or my TV bills via eSeva, and I have to do it at the end of every month. So why do I not have something that runs at the end of every month and pays my bills? It maybe asks for a confirmation, but it could be open source, and it could help a lot of other people. So we've started work on this. If you want to contribute, of course, you can talk to me after. The next thing is, you may need to re-implement the solution. So you may be working on some integration or some API or some task that you know is useful for this project, but maybe you'll have to use it in the future as well. Maybe you're using a custom library that you have to use in the future. You can always open source these kind of things, reusable solutions that you can port to other projects and maybe solve the same problem there as well. The next thing is, the existing solutions don't fit your needs for some reason. And this does not immediately mean that you jump to writing your own solution for this. Maybe you can improve on what's already there, because we don't want to solve problems that have already been solved. I think people who have experienced the problem have solved it in some way. That's a great starting point for us to build upon. Maybe we can send a pull request, right? So maybe we can add some features, maybe we can raise an issue. Let's just not discard libraries because they don't contribute a certain feature. Maybe you can add it to them. We don't know until we start the conversation. The documentation is incomplete or misleading, and this is, I think, by far the most important thing you can do for any open source project. I cannot count the number of times I've been frustrated with libraries because they do not have good documentation, and I have possibly sweared on them as well. But that's not, it's not at that point that you quit the library and you don't use it at all. Maybe you can send in a pull request, maybe you can say, hey, this is my usage pattern, this is how I'm using your library, would you like to add it to the README? Or you'd like to add this feature so that it works for everyone. So I think documentation is by far the most important thing you can do today. And you can do this in your projects today as well. I've been to several projects where you don't even have like getting started instructions, like no one knows how to set up the database. So even that could be open source. And really, you don't need a big problem to open source at all. You get open source even the smallest of things. It doesn't have to be big and grand and demanding of thousands of hours. So I'll give you an example. I don't know if you can read this, but what's important is the third line that says console.log data now. And if you've even never seen code, you can guess what this does. It prints the current date. And this is an actual package on NPM that's downloaded by thousands of people. I'll give you another example. This is just a single line that exports a number. So if you know JavaScript, you know you have something called set timeout, and there's a max number limit that you can pass to it. And this is the number. And I especially the first one, I think, I looked at the library and I was genuinely frustrated. Who would ever write a library that logs the current date? It's so obvious. It shouldn't even be a problem. And these are two libraries by this man called Syndesaurus. If you know who this guy is, you know that if you were to take out all his packages from NPM, from the Node ecosystem, nothing would run. I can guarantee you that nothing will run if you take his packages out. He's by far the highest contributing person on NPM. He has over 1,100 packages. And he's fine pushing stuff like console.log data now, even though he has complex repositories which do several different things. He's fine with solving a small problem. And I think the gist that I want you to take away from this is that no one really cares what repositories you push on GitHub. If he is man enough to have to push three lines of code as a package, you should be man enough to push the repository to GitHub on whatever open source you're working on. And speaking of small things and just, I see one thing really underutilized, and that's gist.github.com. And if you've not used gist.github.com, it's basically a platform from github.com where you can create small files, maybe one or two files, to encapsulate small systems. Like you won't, it's not like GitHub where you have an entire system there, but it's like small gists of information that you can store. And this is vastly underutilized. And there are some obvious problems you can create gists out of. So you can store small information that work with a few lines. So maybe I'll use some GitHub's API to do to fetch the commits of a user. I think if I use the GitHub API, I think I would make a gist out of it just so that I remember it for the next time. I have a solution for the next time. So this is really the kind of problems that you can solve with gist. Another is code snippets. If there's any designers in the room, they would probably know how to center a div, but I, for the life of me, cannot remember to vertically center a div. And this is something I stored in gist or github.com. I copy it every time, I never remember it. And one thing I'd like to say about this is that it doesn't need to be technical. People write entire blog posts on gist. People write their cooking recipes on gist. If it's something that can be written as a short note, it can be used as gist. So it doesn't need to be technical, use whatever you want. And this is basically the kinds of problems you should be introspecting in your own projects. You might not even think of stuff like this as problems, but if you can open source it, maybe try to find a solution with people around you, maybe communicate to them, can I make this open source? That's always the question you should be asking yourself. And I think I want to share a short introduction to how I got started into open source and how I realized that there was something missing in my project and I could improve upon it. So maybe, hopefully, this you can take something away from this to your projects and maybe you can do something there as well. So the problem I had was with mobile app deployments. And if you've, like, a long time back, I was a mobile app developer. Well, not so long ago, but it feels like a long time ago. And if you know, if you've been to the web and you see how deployments are done, you push it to a server, you have continuous integration and continuous delivery, and you know what it's like to deploy to a server and what continuous delivery is, you know what the state of mobile deployments is in the mobile world. There isn't any. There is no continuous delivery, at least not in the way you think of it in the web. So I'll just briefly explain how it was and how we tried to solve it. The state of mobile deployments was we worked on React Native. So we had this long, like 10-page, not exactly 10 pages, but it's like a really long documentation that you had to follow step by step. And if you mess one thing up, the whole thing would fall apart. So you had to generate a build following that long documentation. And you didn't have any way to send it. So naturally, some people would use HipChat, some people would use Google Drive, some use Slack, and we used email. So we attached it to an email and sent. Like, we always had this boilerplate content like, hello, project manager name, this is the build as of this date, and stuff like that. So it was a nightmare, literally. And if you had to push a small fix, if you had to push one line of code, then you'd have to do the entire thing again. There was no way around it. And maintaining build history is, of course, a nightmare. You are sending so many emails that you cannot even keep track of them. Like, there are more emails than you get from these deployments than you get from Jira, and that's saying a lot. So the broader problem here is that there aren't any develop, deploy, and feedback cycles that we're used to in the web. There isn't a central server where you push your mobile deployments to and where you get instant feedback from your QAs or from your project managers. If you need to deploy a fix, it's the same process again. It's like a one-click deployment. So you didn't really have this in the mobile world. As I said, we had a dev.project.com where we could continuously deploy. If something worked, it was fine. If something didn't work, we would deploy another fix. And if it was fine, we'd just tag it. So that was the end of the story. And for someone who's moving from this style of deployments to the mobile style, it's really difficult. And the first solution before this was we created a Python script that would do the exact same thing that I mentioned. Like, it would do all the documentation steps, and then it would attach it to an email and attach some random content to it and send it. So we even had a fake email address to do this. But the broader problem, the solution to this broader problem would eventually take the name of Harbor. And it was a mobile app that allowed for painless release cycles. And people who've used this probably know I'm sort of overstating what it did. But it had innate support for build history management, continuous delivery pipelines, release audiences, rollbacks, etc. So this was the deeper problem that we're trying to solve with this. And it had one-click deployments. So this was something I really missed from the world of the web, where everything is just deployed to UAT or something, and it would just work. And it worked. We tried it in a couple of projects, and it worked fine. But in some, didn't quite. So we realized that we had some problems with it. It was built in a very prototypish sort of way, so you can really extend it. So we realized that we had some problems with this and needed to improve upon it. And currently, we're working on version 2. We have architectural changes, revamped UI. Avastha is helping with that. So lots of changes are planned, and we're switching programming languages from Python to Go, and Python is a nightmare to deal with. And it has several buzzwords you might know, like React Native, Go, Docker, Kubernetes, etc. So, and of course, active development is underway, and if you want to contribute, pull requests are always welcome. So this is really the problem that I saw in my project, and maybe you can see something similar in yours, and maybe you can extrapolate a solution that works for more than just your project and more than just the people around you. Maybe you can make it open source. Can I make this open source? That's the magic question, I think. Okay, so basically you know what open source is. You want to contribute. It seems like a good idea. It seems that it doesn't need to be associated with too much baggage. You can just think of open source in this vacuum where you're trying to solve problems and you're trying to like find solutions that work for multiple teams. So if you think of it this way, what are the next steps? The first step is GitHub's open source handbook. I cannot stress enough how good this is. This is like a really beginner-friendly, non-intimidating guide to open source and basically tells you what sort of things you should be writing in your README, what sort of license you should be using, how you can invite more people to your project, how you can be exposed to more projects. And this is like a really good book. There's another talk by the guy, Max Stoiber, I mentioned earlier, who says, I want you to contribute to open source. This is like a really good guide as well. The problem he had was he wanted to have social media sharing buttons, like the share to Facebook and share to Google type of buttons. And the way you did that was you copied a script tag from the Facebook documentation page and you pasted it into your HTML page. And those were really big, like 70 KB big. And that's really, really big. And if you just had four, you'd get like half a megabyte of script tags. And so he started really simple projects to sort of reverse engineer how they did the sharing. And he did it in, I think, less than 50 kilobytes or something. And another thing is that's really good is you can look for beginner-friendly labels on GitHub issues. So if I think all of you know GitHub and all of you know the issue system. So you can put labels on it. Like even big projects like React have this standard where you can place like beginner-friendly, good first issue, stuff like this. So you can search for those. And the issues are so descriptive that they tell you exactly what needs to be changed. Maybe it's just a README change. Maybe you need to change five lines. And they'll tell you exactly the five lines of code you need to change as well. And it's really simple. And you can start contributing right now. And everyone started with a README change. Everyone started with fixing one line of code. Everyone started with adding a semicolon or something like that. So I think you should be starting with beginner-friendly issues and moving on from there. And I think we are pretty lucky that we have a company that appreciates open source. And we have in-house projects that are moving open source to the right direction, that are fostering this culture of open source in our company. And I think it's a great opportunity for everyone to be involved. I think Pratish is Parang as well. Like, it's a really simple project. Like, the concept is really, really simple. But it's a project that solves a simple problem and it's useful for everyone here. So I think projects like that, projects like Chowthari, in-house projects that are really useful, I think you can get started with those as well. If you have any ideas, you can bring them forward. Maybe someone else has the same problem. So I think really speak up if you have any ideas, talk to them as well. We have an open source project on the LF Technology website as well, where your open source work can be featured as well. And I think this is a great opportunity. Right. So if you take nothing away from this talk, like if you just think I'm harping on some bullshit or whatever, you can take these things away. You should always ask yourself, can I make this open source? And this is really the question you can ask in each pull request that you send to your private repositories. Can I make something open source? Can I maybe extrapolate this function to a separate library? Can I make that open source? And this is really the magic question. Always ask yourself, can I make this open source? Because not everything makes sense to be open sourced. And you can try to improve upon existing solutions. Do not reinvent the wheel. I cannot stress this enough. Do not reinvent the wheel. If something doesn't work to you, for you, you can always improve the wheel. So you should be always looking to improve upon existing solutions rather than creating your own. The third thing I want you to take away is it's all right if you create the smallest of things. You can create three lines of code and it can be a repository and no one really cares what you're doing. And you shouldn't really care how other people use your library as well. You should be just, it should solve your problem, but you shouldn't be limited by the fact that no one's using it. If it works for you, if it solves your problem, it's fine. And it might not work the first time around. I think I've had first time experience with this that it does not work the first time around. It probably won't work the first time around, but it's better than not doing anything at all. It's really important. And I think lastly, it's an amazing learning experience. We use hundreds of libraries every day. We use hundreds of open source projects every day. But how many of us really know what's going on under the hood? How many of us really know how they're doing it? And for me, this was Webpack. So if you're familiar with Webpack, we use Webpack every day in our React projects. So I really dove into the source code and see how they did things. And it's really simple. It's like this massive repository, but it's really, really simple. And you can do this with any library that you're using or any open source project that you're using, and it's, if even if you don't contribute, just reading the code or just opening an issue or just saying, or just informing people that, hey, this might not work, this could be better done using this, that counts as contributions too. It doesn't always have to be code, and it doesn't always have to be this huge change. You can contribute in the smallest way. And in the open source world, I think I haven't encountered any person that didn't appreciate a single full stop change or a single semicolon change. I think it's an amazing opportunity to learn as well. So I think that's pretty much what I have for you today. Generally, people conclude with a thank you or thank you for listening to me. But I think since this is an open source talk, I want to conclude with, I want to conclude with pull requests are welcome. Thank you.